The skeleton had been retreating to the roof, which suggested that the person with knowledge of medicine had been responsible for an anatomical dissection. Parts of the body which would have indicated sex were missing, and the head was also not present.
What parts of the head? Dark at the roots, some still clasped by the little hair curls were found. Cora Crippen, though of the womb, had for some time been dying her hair dormant. A warrant was issued for the arrest of Crippen and his female companion, his secretary and mistress, Ethel and Wolf. Descriptions and pictures of Crippen and Wolf were seen throughout the country. The story was broadcast news, and the public's imagination was caught by the heavy mix of the gruesome Sarah discovery and the affair between Crippen and a much younger woman. The police extended the search around the world. There were dozens of sightings in the country. One man, thought to be Crippen, narrowly escaped the lynching by an excited crowd. But nearly 2 weeks later, there was still no convincing sighting. Then a great one evening, Inspector Jew was handed the telegram that would dramatically alter the course of the investigation. The telegram was from a ship called Montrose, which had sailed from Antwerp and was bound for Quebec in Canada. Amongst the passengers were a father and son, both called John Robinson. After 2 days at sea, the ship's captain, Jim McKinney, became struck by the likeness of the Robinsons to the newspaper photos of the seven-man fugitive and his friend. He also noticed that the father and his very attractive son would hold hands and gaze at each other. He was so convinced he had Crippen and Lee on his ship that he ordered the Macomi operator to send a telegraph to the Canadian Pacific office in Liverpool. The Red had strong suspicion that Crippen, another seven-man, accomplice amongst passengers, the star